I'm Emmanuel Guillot from CNRS-PROMES, and I will be speaking for flux measurements. As usual, don't hesitate to cut me to ask questions and hear process. Don't hesitate. I have to put one picture of where I work, and I chose a picture with snow because here, from my area, there is rarely snow, or never snow. So, and I'm in charge of the department, for solar facilities and dissociative instruments. So, about these three numbers, there is one which is not a characteristic of the facility itself. Which one is it?
Peak temperature.
Yeah, good. So now I can go. Yeah, peak temperature. Peak temperature depends on the process. So I will be speaking about the others. So what are flux measurements? What I intend to share with you. And then how to measure it. So there are two sets of methods. We call it direct methods and indirect methods. So flux measurements, it's indeed characteristic of the solar facility, concentrating solar facility, at least what I will be discussing today. It's measuring the thermal. I put a picture of the solar furnace also because on the solar furnace, both optical features needed to concentrate solar energy are with different systems. You have on one hand the stuff to collect the solar energy as the sun moves. You need to have something move and collect it. And this, the size of this system, by A, it will give you an idea of the power. And then the second characteristic, the second feature, is to the concentration. And this time it's a power density. And it is done on the solar furnace by the parabola, or the secondary optics. And this, you cannot see by A, how good it is, what would be the concentration ratio. We need to measure it. And it's tricky. So I will be speaking about flux measurements because this is what we commonly use as word, but it is not the proper word. It should be so irradiance for flux density, power density, and power is power. This is for radiometry. It's not for photometry, which is the same physical principle, but between radiometry and photometry, for photometry there is the sensitivity of the A, human A, in between. So it's candelas and nits and stuff like this. So this is not what I will be discussing. So, measuring thermal energy, what per square meters, in total, this power facility, so it's complete power, in its variation in space, so in volume or on the surface, or in time. This is the kind of results, so you have already seen for the last days. So usually 2D data, you have seen it. This one is in gray levels, it's not yet calibrated, so this is from one of the areas that of this solar furnace. We can have different planes, measuring different planes along the focal axis to do very nice 3D graphics, but if somebody tells me how to read this, I'm always interested. It looks nice on the posters, but it's not very convenient for whatever. So that's 3D data. That's 2D and time variation. So for example, once again, this is for one heliostat. It's the same picture I've shown you on the first one, so this kind of ellipsoidal or whatever, and what its position variation during time. So this is for a few hours. This is not DNI, it's a peak flux of this focal point. So once again, that's gray levels, we are not at 2 square kilowatt per square meters. Another way to represent it is like this. So on one axis, deviation of this focal point, So here, for example, it's to monitor tracking performance of heliostats. If you have seen at a small tower here, we don't have this shape here. I guess it's to compensate for the backlash. The heliostat moves and goes back to the position for the tracking. It's the same, it's not a continuous movement. You have seen it here? And you'll probably be seeing it here. It's not the same. This is from a CMR, so it depends on some mechanics in the difference. So that's again for explosions. With this, I started to show. At first, we had, for example, we can have a 2D data, so this picture with a lot of points. With a lot of points, when you want to compare or when you want to monitor over time what's happening, that's a lot of data. So we have different ways to reduce this data set. So, of course, speed, value, and location, so maximum, barycenter. So, once again, here there is no definite definition. When we show here is a focal point, what is a focal point? Is it really the peak? Is it the average of the most, the highest value? And are we using the wall, for example, when we compute the barycenter? Are we using the whole wall data? Are we using just a subset because we have noise, for example, or simply because the target is too small? This, we choose, depends, and the result changes. So for data reduction, the most common, Manuel, for example, showed it yesterday or about Tona 2, we are using image moments to check the spread of the energy along axes. So that's the questions. So here it's the normal barycenter. Just different moments along different levels. We can, at the end, define, so when it's antithesis, it works very well, the equivalent ellipsoidal, so both axes, the size of the ellipse, and the orientation of the ellipse with the image moment. So here is the size of the ellipse, its eccentricity, and here, for example, the orientation with this image moment. So this is quite common. It works very well when you have one spot, but for example, with the heliostat with several mirrors, you have different mirrors, different spots, and this goes in the wall. Or at least you have data, but difficult to change. So that was. This was about the parameters and what we can do with it. I said there are two sets to measure this. So on one hand, direct methods, so sensors which directly measure thermal power. And on the other hand, indirect methods, where you have to post-process it, you don't directly measure the data, you need to process it. And it's a longer process, but depends what is the best, the most convenient for a system. So this is what we'll be presenting now. About direct methods, this is the most common. So Gardon gauges, calorimeters, thermoelectric sensors, and from other fields, there are also pyroelectric sensors, photonic sensors, and what is common with every all of these, is we are doing measurement in one place, so you have something physical, you have to put in your beam, and then you get a signal about this energy. So Gardon gauges, this is what it looks like. So the Gardon gauge from Battelle are by far the most common, the most used. Everybody in the papers, everybody uses them, or also happens. So in the picture, I put one, so it looks like a copper cylinder, about this big. The usual size is 1 inch, it's American. The principle is to measure the density inside, that's the Gardon gauge, and as it is a known material, it's a known activity, with thermal loss we can calculate the quantity of heat which goes through it. And also, if we know the optical absorptivity, how much it has absorbed, we can calculate the power density, the average power density on the sensor. So this is how it looks like in cross-section. So you have your cylinder, and if you cut it like this, so there is a heat sink here, so which is a copper tube, let's say. Usually for trough, it can be just like this, passive heat sink. But for towers, for example, it's usual we have a cooling, water cooling, to cool it, otherwise it gets too hot. So you have the copper, you have the thin foil in the center of the constanton, and this constanton, at least in French it's constanton. So the foil, constanton, whatever, and copper, this is a thermocouple. And in between, so between the foil in the center, we put a wire here, and on the edge also a wire on the heat sink, the copper heat sink. So in between we make a thermocouple. And the temperature which is measured by the thermocouple is the average between where is the wet spot in the center, so I can move here, and here the heat sink. So here we send the heat flux. This gets warm. Here, because it's supposed to be cooled enough, it should be cooled, much cooler. So we measure the difference of temperature here on the side. So this is all. And then, for example, Vattel, when you order a garden gauge from Vattel, the signal output is always the same. It's normal range, 15 millivolts, maximal reasonable range, 20 millivolts, and we usually burn them around 25, 28, or maybe 30 millivolts. So that's always the same, the voltage output. And you ask for a range, so you want to measure from 0 to 100 kilowatt per square meter, 1,000, 10,000 kilowatt per square meter. And they vary the thickness of the foil and the thickness also of the copper heat sink to change the lambda, the conduction, the conductivity of the system to adapt for the range you're requesting. So that's by far the most common. Okay. So, why is it common? It's because it's quite simple. It's something you can install. For low power, you don't need water, so it's very convenient. It's small. You can install a lot of them on a lot of surface. So I want accurate. This is what we usually say to accurate, repeatable, depends. And this is a typical accuracy, 5 to 10% and rather 10% and 5%. I'll show you here. And if you have, for example, a lot of dust of gas and so on, they can seal it with windows. So either borosilicate windows or fused silica window to protect them from partial fragments, from powders, from whatever can come in. So a lot of people are using this sensor, and especially the one from Vattel. So Vattel has not invented those sensors. In my lab, for example, I wrote that it was commissioned in 72. So people were building them, and because Vattel did not exist at that time, and in every lab they were building their own sensors exactly this way. Just the guy from Vattel to cover the market. That's different fields that typically use those sensors. So the guy for fire protection. So for example, here it's a school room. There should be limitation how long the walls, how long the tables should withstand for fire to save us. And for this, for qualification, they are using this kind of sensors for low range. It's so normal fire is 10-20 cents. For very strong fire, for example, in tunnels, they go to 30-40 cents, so this kind of range. And they have electric furnaces with these sensors to sample and then check when it starts to get to charcoal or to have a flame and this kind of stuff. So this is by far the biggest market. The people from fire, because firemen's standards, people, the standardization organization, and companies who are making furniture, for example, people from combustions, so combustions for cars, for burners to produce electricity, for rockets. So they use this kind of also samples. So us, CSP. I'm using solar furnaces, so we can go up to 15,000 cents, but that's exotic. So usually it's a few thousand cents. So as you know, a tower is up to 500, 800. With secondary optics, we can reach a few thousand. So this is depends kind of limits. And this is so it's a guy from plasma. So yesterday, for example, we were speaking about plasma deposits of the coatings. So to monitor the torch, the plasma torch, how strong it is, they use this kind of sensors to measure what is the thermal effect of the torch. It's quite common. And here the guy from plasma, they go with very, very, very high flux. It's twice, three times this kind of number, it's insane. And as there is a plasma, it erodes very quickly the sensor. So for them, the accuracy is when it's brand new and 2 minutes after, it's already all the condition factors are bad. It's awful conditions. So, as it's quite widespread and quite old sensor, we know what's wrong with them. But it's not because we know what's wrong with them that we correct all of it. So the main problem is this heating. We are measuring the delta T. So the delta T is between the center spot, so here we are heating, and the cool part. And the issue is, how cool is it? Is it really cool? For example, the common issue is to use tap water to cool the system. We are, for low flux, for example, we are doing a temperature increase by 5, 10, 20 degrees, very small. And tap water, here in the room, for example, when you start the tap, the water you will be first will be at room temperature for a few minutes. So, for example, 20 something degrees. Then, after a few minutes, it will come from the main pipes inside the building. It will be a big colder. Or for example, in Odeo, as we heat those pipes to avoid freezing, we have higher temperature pipes, whatever. And then, once again, after, if you wait a bit longer, you will get from the main utility, and once again, another temperature. And that's, again, by a few degrees change. And this, for the delta T, it will change a bit what you measure with your sensor. The other big issue, Audrey showed yesterday about absorptivity and coatings and stuff like this. It's what is the absorptivity right now of the sensor? So you have a very, usually it's a very nice pen, so it's not a power mark, it's a cold sensor, it's a xenolite or very nice pens. We know the absorptivity when it's brand new. You have a sensor, it got dirty with dust. It can get cracked because you move it. And so, what is really the absorptivity of your sensor changes. And 1-2% absorptivity change means 1-2% of your error offsets your bias on your measure. So, you're wrong. And you don't know how much you're wrong. Convection losses. So, I showed you the small foil with the heat coming in and the heating. That's, if you have convection, you are cooling also your heat foil. So for the same amount of irradiation, your sensor will be cooler. So that's again an issue. Directionality, it's once again because we have a paint, and the paint is not perfectly flat. If you remember yesterday on the about reflectivity and absorptivity, they said it depends on the bulk material, what it is, but also what is the shape, the structure. So for example, we have seen on the sensor which were painted with brushes. The brush was in one side, so we had ropes in one side but not in the other side. And when we had 20-30 degrees incoming beam on the angle, we had some shadowing and some data a bit lower depending on the direction. And Yeah, plus thermal sensor. This is a low signal. It's a thermocouple, so it's very small signal. Yes?
What's the dimension of this loge? The dimension?
Usually it's 1 inch. 1 inch, 25 millimeters. You can buy it bigger, but it's not very common. Smaller, yes, half an inch, 2/3 inch. Okay. It's because it's American, so it's yes. And here in the sensitive part, I've not mentioned here because for CSP we don't care, but so it's about this big. You have the copper, you have the foil, and you have the wire in it. And the wire is not centered, it's welded, nearly centered. So for example, the guy from laser, when they use it, they scan with the laser with one square millimeter of where you are. And for example, on the center, they have a different signal than 1 or 2 millimeters away. So for non CSP application, we don't care. But for example, for CTV, concentrated photovoltaics, when you use very small solar cells, this once again, where you put your sensor and you offset it by a few millimeters, you can get once again 5, 10, 20% differences because of this. So I started to speak about calibration. Because the sensor is only as good as calibration, okay, so how you use it, but also where does calibration come from. So this is, for example, colleagues from TMAT, so ASUS Palestrine. This is how we calibrate sensors. So he has a graphite plate, so here on the table, in the air. It hits it at 1,400 degrees, something like this. You remember, Marcos? Something like this. And there are two sensors on each side of the graphite plate. So one is a reference sensor, and the one is calibrating. How he calibrates the reference sensor? So he removed the customer sensor, and here he put a pyrometer to measure the temperature, the actual temperature of the plate. As it is graphite, and when it is new graphite, he knows the emissivity of the plate, so he can calculate from the temperatures he measures, from the brightness he measures, he can calculate the temperature, from the temperatures he measures, he can calculate the quantity of power density which is sent from the sensor. So this is, for example, one way to calibrate sensors. And one tricky thing, for example, is when ASUS is calibrating half, 2/3 of the sensors which are used in Spain, so most of the sensors for CCP doubles. And this is very recent, for example, it compensates for solar spectrum. So when he receives the sensor, he sends it, he puts his coating, the xenolite coating, which is in fact the old coating from the battery, but is the one he has characterized what is its solar, its spectrum, spectral absorbance, how does it age, the water sensitivity, stuff like this. So he sends it, he puts his xenolite coating, and one thing he corrects is this plate is only 1,000-2,000 degrees, so it's not. It's very far from the spectrum of the sun, which is at around 6,000 degrees. So between those two spectrum, it calculates what is the actual absorbance between infrared calibration at here and the actual solar calibration. And this is a few percent changes in the numbers. One second. When the xenolite is burned. The other common way, so this is from in our lab, is to install the sensor on the CSP facility and to have a reference sensor and to compare with it. So for the reference sensor, which will come after, we usually use calorimeters. It's further here. About garden. So this is the most common, it's ink, the foil, thermocouple, in between. We use also other thermoelectric sensors, so still with thermoelectric effect, but with different spatial organization. So for either one of these advantages, so garden gauges, the speed depends on the thickness of the foil. So it's usually a few hertz, 10 hertz, 100 hertz. But for example, to check very quickly the tracking, for example, the effects of the wind on the aerostat and the backlash, sometimes we want to go for higher speed. So this is CI range. This is a major issue if you have on a tower, we have a lot of winds. So this is, for example, one very common sensor, not that much for CSP, because usually this one, for example, for Nexopax, this one is made for universities mostly, and it's around with in it, it's a temperature, or it is for fire. Nexopax go to a few hundreds kilowatts per square meter, so don't go very high. And in it, so you have two metal plates. So this one, I think it's aluminium. And here, this is a thermocouple. So this is, for example, it can still be constant and copper. Here you can have constant copper. So you are measuring the delta T between the top and the bottom part. And because you have one here, a series of thermocouple, thermocouples between series, you add the signal. So here for this kind of sensor, instead of having millivolts, you can get volts or at least 100 of millivolts of signal. So if you have electric engines nearby or stuff like this and you cannot change it on something like this, this kind of sensor can be very convenient. The issue is, I spoke a bit about the size of the garden gauge, so the foil with the thermocouple. So we have something which is more or less 1 centimeter size of the sensitive size. Here, this one I think is 40 millimeters. And this is, you are averaging the power on 40 millimeters with video. Okay, so far? That's another way. It's the same principle or the trick here, all the thermocouples are arranged in the shape. It's more or less the same principle. You have the two films. And here, this one is done in the lithography. The deposits has different thickness of one times thermocouple from very thin layers. This is 300 micron thick. Half one third of a millimeter thick, it's very thin. But what is very interesting is a French company, Captec. Exaflux is Swedish. Captec, this is reflective and black strips. Because, so this is the same thermocouples in series, and like a labyrinth going one way and another, like this. And here, there is half the thermocouples which are below the reflective part, and the other half which are below the black part. And the interesting is when you have cooling or heating per convection, this is convection if you consider it the same on the whole surface, as it impacts both the reflective part and the black part. For the radiative part, it got subtracted. You measure from you measure the power density with this sensor only on the black part. On the reflective part, you measure here 3 times. On the black part, you measure the power density and the convection. On the reflective part, because it's reflective, it's simply silver or aluminium, I don't remember. You measure only the convection part. And below, you have the thermocouples. And so when they are plugged in series, you subtract from the voltage on the measure what you measure on the black part, what is measured on the reflective part. So at the end, you only have Z power density and no more, Z flux density, solar energy, and no more convection losses. So with this sensor, we tried it, for example, we cooled it with air, compressed air, and there is no changes at all on the signal. On the garden gauge, you drop by 5-10% signal when you cool it with compressor. On that sensor, there is another thing. As it is very, very thin, there is nearly no thermal inertia. So this one, we try once again. The temperature of the heat sink, when it changes, it doesn't change the signal. For example, we tried to measure, so about 300 cents, something like this, between very cool sensor, so it was around 30 degrees, and a very hot sensor. This doesn't withstand very high, it withstands 120 degrees. And so by reducing the amount of water, we let it close up, but it was still saying the same amount of flux density. So this one is very convenient for this, less parasitic issues. The issue is it's a bit more expensive, it's a bit more fragile, and it doesn't go very high. We try at 500 cents, we burn them. It starts to make all the sense. Okay. I was saying about calorimeters. That's the next common use, the most common use, but that's more research sensors, because it's not very convenient to involve, but it's way more accurate. So the principle is, it's written here, we measure how much energy is transferred to a fluid, so typically water. So we measure how much fluid we are circulating, what's the increase of temperature of the fluid, and if we know the property of the fluid, we can calculate the power with this very, very complex equation. This is how it can look like. So you have here a cavity. The water comes in the cavity. It goes around like a cylinder. So it goes in, it goes around, and goes out. Even in French. And here we measure how much water we put inside the calorimeter and what is the temperature increase. What you see here is a very important system, is the diaphragm. So this is from a schematic from a calorimeter for our solar furnaces. So as we have a lot of power on our solar furnaces, we need very quickly a lot of water to protect the system. So the diaphragm is water cooled. This is why here there is this bridge from the outer shell, which is water cooled for our solar furnaces, and goes to store. So diaphragm is very important because this is what defines what is your sensitive area, on which size, where, and how big you are measuring the power. So this is how it can look like. So is once again the diaphragm, the inner shell, that's the insulation, that's another calorimeter, so that's more normal insulation. This is nylon, for example. And inside, it's a piping in which we pour water and we measure temperature. So you remember the formula to measure the quantity of water, measure the density, and to know the properties. So to measure the quantity of water, we have different ways to do it. So the cheapest, easiest, is our volumetric flow meters, the one you have on your house with the small turbine to measure how much water you are going to pay for. So that's volumetric flow meters. There are other mass flow meters, for example, with eddy currents, vortex flow meters, or hot wires, or diaphragm, a lot of flow meters. The Coriolis flow meters are, this is for example what we use in our labs, and with the Coriolis effect, so you have a bent pipe, and when the water goes through, because it's bent, because of centrifugation. It's dense because it's like an omega, it's a ground omega. So you have the water going like this, and here, because it's turning, the water, it's bending a bit the pipe, either in in the wall or out of the wall, depending on which the water goes, because of the water flow. And here, if you put gauges to measure the bending of the pipe, you can calculate what the mechanical deviation of the pipes, and calculate how much mass of water has caused this deviation of the pipe. So the Coriolis flow meters are the common way to measure very accurately a flow. For example, for tankers, for oil, this is what we use in reference laboratories. Yes, always. There are other ways which are more accurate, but don't give you as much information. So one way is to use a vessel. You pour water in it, and you just check how much time it takes to fill the vessel. So that's very easy, it's very convenient, it's very accurate. But the issue is, you have one measure, for example, per minute. If your vessel takes 1 minute to fill in, you have one measure for this minute. You cannot do continuous measurements. With weighting, it's an improvement. So you have small vessels, and you measure the weight, the accumulation of weight in your vessel. But once again, that's for laboratories. This is what I was saying about volumetric flow meters. So of this vessel, for example. And okay, you have you know the volume of water, but what we want to know is the mass of water to calculate how much energy we have given to this mass. And volume, the correction from volume to mass depends on your fluid. So this is, for example, for pure water. For tap water, it's not pure, so it's different numbers. And it depends on temperature. So this is, once again, a few below, typically it's below 1%, but around 1% error we do if we don't compensate for this. That was for how much water we are eating. How much do we eat it? So this is the usual stuff to measure temperature for this kind of setup. Thermocouples, either installed, let's say normally, so you have the thermocouple, one thermocouple on the hot, on the cold side, one on the hot side, so with the two wires, and you have two measures of temperature, so that's the normal stuff. Differential thermocouple, so once again you have two thermocouples, but instead of plugging both separately on your data acquisition system, you put them in series. So here you have only one thermocouple to be plugged on your data acquisition system, and what you measure is the delta T and between both points. So for this, for example, you need a third thermocouple either on the cold or hot part to have an idea what is the temperature of your fluid for this mass compensation or CP compensation. PT100, so they are bigger, they are slower, but it's much cheaper to get them calibrated with a lot of digits. So it's quite convenient for this. For example, in my lab we are using PT100, and the accuracy is 300 of degree Celsius. It's quite easy to do this. With thermocouples, it's when you buy for a thermocouple, you get half a degree uncertainty. If you want to get better performance measurement, you need to calibrate them yourself. So yeah, and speaking of half a degree, 1/3. On calorimeters, usually we heat the water by a few degrees, 5, 10, 15 degrees at most. Because if we heat more, on the wall of the calorimeters, we have thermal losses. And those thermal losses, we have to subtract it to measure them. And once again, it's tricky. What are we really doing? So we are increasing the error. So one compromise is to have a cold calorimeter, more or less at the room temperature, not to be very far, to be in stable conditions. Or, for example, at DLR, they have a calorimeter where there is electric heating in it. So they heat the calorimeter in the lab, in the furnace. They heat it and check, they know how much electricity they put inside it, and they check how much they measure to determine what is the heat losses. There are other ways with electric heating, for example, for the guy for dosimetry, who are using also calorimeter, which much higher performance. They are heating them at its temperature, always, whatever the power they put in it. So they subtract from the power they measure, the pressure, the power they are injecting on the electric side to keep it in track. And those guys are using RTD. For example, on RTD, they have, I've seen papers, they were measuring 1 billion names of Kelvin. This was their uncertainty. Six digits after zero for their uncertainty. But that's very one paper. So once we know how much water we have heated, by how much we have heated it, we have to calculate how much energy we have actually stored in the water. And the issue is Cp, so the heat capacity. So that's the same for a trough or a plant, when you really want to measure how much power you have put in your system. So how good are your optics, and how good is your tracking, how good are your tubes, how good is your fluid, you are doing calorimetry. And once again, we have to compensate for what is the actual Cp. And this formula, the one which is commonly used, is once again for pure water. You see here, we have, I think it's 5% difference between pure cold water and room temperature water, at least in the view. Here it's warmer. That's how much. So with the previous slides, we calculate how much energy we have stored. But we still don't know how much was really accepted from the facility. This is from the absorptivity. So I said for the garden gauges, for example, we had flux. So how much light, how much electromagnetic energy is absorbed depends on the absorptivity. Here, because we always do a cavity, even with a very bad paint, so 75% of absorbance, which is a black paint, a good black paint, but old, a few months old. If we do a cavity, so an opening and then a cylinder, because there is a diffusion inside the cavity, and all of this light which is diffused into the cavity, its energy is given to the water, so nothing, nearly nothing is lost, there is very few coming out. When you have a cavity where the lens is about 4 times the diameter of the cavity, so that's the beginning of the chart, you already absorb 98% of the incoming energy. That's why also on towers, for example, to improve the thermal efficiency, we are using cavities to keep the energy in it, to improve by 5, 10, 20% the energy which is transferred to the process. That's exactly the same principle. Just here, we are pushing a bit further, so we are making signatures. So, for the laser, for example, which are in the national laboratories to measure the power from laser, they are using calorimeters, and they are making it like cones. So you have the laser coming in, the laser is quite straight beam, and so it's always bouncing inside the cone, so everything is in it. They have absorptivities, of course not one, but 3, 4, 5 times they can calculate of the actual energy which is transferred from the incoming beam to the flux. So this is why we use calorimeters to calibrate garden gauges, because of the optical subtlety. Those sensors are local. I got asked, so 1 inch, you do the measurement on 1 point. So that's nice, but it's small for a trough or a tower, with a bigger part. So the normal thing is to use many sensors or to move them or both. So for example, here, once again, is from ASUS, ASUS Palestine in PSA. So on one of the tower, he has done this, so there is this bar with a motor which moves like this. He has a few sensors, and during time, he does this kind of measure. This is the position where he gets the measurement with, this is with Gardon gauges, battery Gardon gauges. And this is the kind of maps he's producing at the end. He interpolates the data in between the location, and he can calculate a 2D flux map. The moving bar takes 1-2 seconds to go in front of the cavity of the receiver. Odelio, a long time ago, they were doing exactly the same with calorimeters. It's very, very small diaphragms, the same to, for 2D scanning with one sensor. It's 2D scanning, so you need stable conditions to do this. No, the last slide about sensors to measure power density. So, Gardon gauges, calorimeters, that's by far the most common. Here, this idea is to benefit from so photonic sensors, so PV cells, photodiodes. So, we use, that's the actual, an actual device, we do an integrating sphere. So this one was in aluminium, machine in aluminium, water cooled once again, because it's for the extra furnace. You have a small opening, this is the one you see here. The solar energy comes in. In it, you have a highly reflective white material, so whatever you can do, which is like this. We cannot use the usual white lab sphere coating, because the usual white lab sphere coating withstands barely 100 degrees. So on this one, for example, it was magnesium oxide, smoked magnesium oxide. And the idea of the integrating sphere is you have your energy coming from the small opening, and because your sphere is perfectly diffusive, all the energy is diffused evenly inside the sphere. So here, wherever you are, you should have the same flux density. So at one point, you put your sensor to measure the energy. And on this kind of sensors, we're using photodiodes. The advantage of photodiodes are they are very fast. So for example, one of the first qualification of the solar furnace in Odelio, this is 10,000 or at that time 16,000 kilowatt per meter. They had a sensor like this, the other one, moving on the bar very quickly. It was 5 meters per second. And in the report, so that was 40 years ago, there are, when it was starting to move, there was a switch on the bar to start a camera, and the camera was taking a picture of an oscilloscope, because on the oscilloscope there was a peak of voltage from the photodiode, from the signal when it was moving through the bar. So this is first measurement long time ago. For high voltage. Zoom one. So I put them at the end because I don't like them. It's people from laser. If you open a book at the solar apps or in moon optics, you'll find this. You see very nice ready systems, so water cool, not water cool. Once again, the same principle, integrating sphere, really everything said. So it's either Gardon gauges, either parametric sensors or photonic sensors, depending on the flux level, water cooled, not water cooled, with Peltier effects, passive, a lot of them, with nice setup and you have watts and curves and whatever. The issue is it is built, solved for laser. So when you see 99.5% of self-absorptivity, it's for one wavelength, and usually for the YAG, so 1064 nanometer. As we are using solar energy, which runs more or less from 400 nanometers to make something, okay, you have very good absorptivity at one wavelength. We have no idea what's happening on the other wavelengths. So these kind of sensors, they are very nice, but they are not calibrated for us. So with it, for example, colleagues wrote one of those, it's thermal like this, and it's 5 to 10% off. And once again, the exact location of the measurement with this, we don't know exactly. With a laser, this can be quite common to know where the special sensitivity of the sensor. This looks like a good idea, but this is not. And it should be the last. So that was the sensors which directly measure flux measurements. Now, indirect methods. I present two or mostly camera based system for ray tracing. I really go over it. Manuel has spoken about it yesterday, Cyril also. So, but ray tracing, I go very fast. Camera based. So, okay, I was speaking of a sensor, I need a lot of them, I need to move them, but it's not very convenient to get spatial distribution. Why not use a camera? So, we do use a camera, and this is, these are the main components which interacts with the measure. So, we have the source, the sun, depending on how it is. We are looking on the screen, on the target. So where is it? By which angle? And we are using the camera to try to determine the brightness of the target. And at the end, what is really the power density on the target? Yes?
Can this camera catch any other lights than other colors more than white, or it's only catch for white colors?
You will see in a few slides. Depends, as you want. It's a question of how you calibrate it. What is common is to use visible cameras. What is very common is to use visible monochrome cameras. We are among those who place with color cameras because we have spectral sensitivity and can be interesting. People have used infrared cameras to do flux measurements. I don't really see the point, but it has been done. Yes?
The place of the camera, behind the place of the camera.
Yes.
Fix it behind the sort of the wheel.
Okay.
Understand.
Here, on this picture. So this is from one of our solar furnaces in the video. So on this facility, you have a bottom, an aerostat, which sends the solar energy on the top. Here, you have the sun, the aerostat, and we have a parabola. And here is where there is a target, and the camera is looking through the target. That's the setup in picture. On a tower, so what is common is, you have seen, for example, there was a picture, ISO Sherman Solar display. So you have the tower with the receiver where you have the actual tubes or whatever. And below, there is a white target. So there are cameras in the field to look at this white target. That's the common setup. For trough, it's very tricky because for a trough, because we have the tube at focal point, we cannot install something. So there are, it's not very commonly used cameras to measure flux for trough because you cannot access it. Say, for example, on the tubes around it, we can put, so if we have the trough like this, we can put a plate here and look once again what's going on this target. But it's not this plane where you have the energy, you are looking more at the direction of the light inside the plate than what is really at the focal point. For a trough, it's not very convenient to install trough. Have I answered? Or
I think it's difficult to use a camera in the solar tower because the distance. I think you need a measurement to walk.
Yeah. If it's distance, it's every solar tower has camera. I don't know if as I told you, for example, for commissioning tower, I first shown one of the first slides the tracking accuracy of the of Neviostat. When you build a Neviostat, you need to track very accurately to send it on the tower. And when it's brand new, all the defect of the Neviostat, it's not perfectly vertical, it's not perfectly at 90 degrees between the angles and so on. How to calibrate them, the usual way is to put it roughly on the white target and with a camera system to check where it is on the target and to compensate this. For a typical tower, it takes 6 months, 1 year to commission a solar tower because of this critical commissioning of the heliostats. And when you have cheap heliostats with cheap encoders, which is not always but quite common for industrial towers, in fact they do it continuously because after a few months, the calibration, or 1 year, 2 years, the calibrations got wrong or too much bad and not accurate enough, you are any outside of the receiver. So in fact, for example, on Tremasola or the PSN or Invanta, all of these towers, if you look on them, there are always 80% of the heliostats which are as FS, and always one which is being calibrated or checked. So on towers, yes, we are far, 100, 200, 500 meters away, but that's, it's not a big deal because we can have teleobjective lenses to look at these targets. Cyril spoke yesterday about a very long distance. The beam is no more straight. We are aiming at one direction, and in fact, we are usually vertical on four towers. We are aiming a bit higher or a bit lower depending on the air, what is the temperature of the air, what is inside the air, this kind of stuff. I'm not aware that the people working on towers have put this inside their flux system to compensate for it. They are, because they are looking where is the beam on the target, and this is their reference, even if the system is a bit long. So for sources, the source changes. So solar energy, spectral issues, so the spectrum changes during time with the what is inside the atmosphere. The brightness distribution over the sun, so this is the plot I put once again. So this is logarithm on both scale. This is the inner diameter of the sun, and this is the circumsolar ratio, the halo around the sun. And these are actual, here the plots which are not doing are actual measurements done this at, should be at the TSA a few years ago, 2-3 years ago. And this is the V model that Emmanuel said was in connection with them. So this the issue is when you are measuring, for example, in the morning or in the afternoon, we may have change of this, and it impacts what we are seeing with the camera. So are we when we are doing, this is true for every flux measurement. What are we looking at? Are we looking at a change of the atmosphere or a change of our optics? Is the elevator tracking wrong? Or is it just some halo, some light clouds coming in and just this point? This is always an issue. What are we looking at? It's apparent diameter of the can unit. It changes during the year, so we are not at some distance from the Earth. The source, target. So people have spoken about reflectivity, I didn't talk about reflectivity. That's how white it is, what we are looking. So it was white when it was brand new, it's less reflective, less numbersome when we are using it. So for diffusive materials, we still have we're still looking for which kind of materials and how to assess it with good enough uncertainty. So for the camera, there are a lot of parameters. Camera is very complex stuff. This is depends where, so everything is in this one. There are both intrinsic and extrinsic parameters. Intrinsic parameters are related about the lens, about the sensor itself. So it's geometrical effects. How much energy is coming from the target to the sensor. That's so two kind of sets. So about intrinsic parameters, this is you take a picture with a camera, so a cell phone or whatever. Usually it's not like this. This is what, of course, we want. We want perfectly right lines and stuff like this, but there are usually some kind of distortion. And this is very simple, but usually they are shifted, they are not centered, so it's really a mess. And this is a characteristic of the lens. The lens installed on this camera. If you put the same lens on another camera, if it is not the same sensor, the same size of the sensor, the same distance between the sensor and the lens, you'll get other characteristics. So the common way to calibrate for this is to use, it's very common, so it's very not observed here below this, you use chess boards or dots or whatever, and at different angles to check the matrix to compensate for this. The extrinsic parameters are about where is your target at which distance. So for example, if your target, if you are in normal direction or on the edge. So with intrinsic parameters, you have a very, very nice picture, but you still don't know what is 1 centimeter. So for example, here, it's from our house, Mixer of Nice. This is simply a paper sheet print, A3 paper sheet. Between each shot, there is 1 centimeter. And with this, I can calibrate spatial calibration. What is 1 centimeter? What is horizontal? What is vertical? It starts here. What is the orientation? If we have perspective effects, so for example, here I have a very small perspective effect. I think there is 1 millimeter difference, which I need that. But I can check with this kind of picture the extrinsic parameters. If you start to understand with cameras are very convenient. I put a lot of things here because it's usually overlooked. It looks convenient, but there are many, many issues with them. And they are very tricky to compensate and more difficult to know by how much we compensate them. We are doing measurements here. And how good is your measurement is not only how much digits you have. That's one thing. It's how much you can trust your measurements, the uncertainty. And with the garden gauges, with the calorimeters, with the other sensors, it's quite easier to know how good is your, how much you can trust your sensors, because it's a voltage measurement, you have the physics, it's not that complicated, so you can check the parasitic effects. With the camera system, it's much more complex, so each step you can have errors, you will have errors, we have errors, it's not wrong. But it's very tricky to know by how big is this error, and how much you know about it. So this is why I detect quite a bit camera system. It's many steps. Just before, I was thinking about intrinsic parameters about the lens, about the spread lines. So this is from Flickr, a picture I quickly found. So you probably have it, or in my second, I have it, for example. The dark edges, it's the same, so but it's a human eye for picture, it's go very quickly. It should be constant brightness, but it is not. And as we want to measure brightness, this is awfully important for us to know, are we measuring something, or is it just absorbed by the lens, by the filter, for example. From Tor Labs, once I bought 10 filters the same, and one of the filters, by eye, it looked a bit strange, because probably it was on the side, they do it by on face, Tor Labs. Probably, it was probably on the side, and if you turn, rotate the filter, you don't have the same absorption obstructivity on the filter, depending on the rotation. It's not flat. So the common way to use it, so I put this picture, it's from it's a guy from astronomy, amateur astronomy. So this is flat box, so they try to make something as white, as diffuse as possible to make a flat field to try to check this kind of effects. So this comes from the lens, it's dark edges. If you are not careful, you can also have dust. Some spots when you remove the lens and it gets dirty and it's not that easy to clean. So with this kind of setup you can have an idea what's going on with this. This was the source. I spoke very quickly about the target, a bit more about the optics. Now the camera. So that was about spectrum, it's a color camera. So this is, for example, infrared camera, a color camera. That's a three. So a color camera, all camera have a CCD sensor or CMOS sensor. So common camera have a CCD and CMOS sensor. So it's a matrix with photodiodes. It's millions of photodiodes. And for a color camera, the typical arrangement is to have four nearby pixels, and two are have green filters on them, one has a red filter, and one has a blue filter. That's the usual color camera. Then, for calculation, it's this is called Bayer matrix. Per calculation, at one pixel, you only have one color, and there is a debayerisation. So once again in French, in English, so debayerisation. At one pixel, you use the nearby other color you have to calculate what is the complete color at this location. So this is the common color camera we have all. The camera, so the three filters have ideally this kind of spectrum. It depends on the CCD sensor, on the even if you see it from a Sony sensor, for example, but even two different sensors from Sony will have different absorptivity and transmittivity. And this is ideal. If you check from one pixel to another, it's a bit different. So the three colors, the blue, the green, the red. Here they stop at 700 nanometers because usually for visible camera for to take pictures, there is an infrared filter, which cut off. So this is one of the common one, which cuts the light around 700 nanometers. So here, for example, I took this picture once again from the astronomy guys to take picture of the stars to get more light. They remove the filter, and it can be as good as this. This, for example, on DSLR, I think it was a Canon DSLR a long time ago, to scrap the infrared filter to get a wider range. And then you have typically other bands which cancel. Maybe you have taken pictures of fire, and there was a charcoal, and maybe you have seen pink charcoal. Oh, yes. So it's because their infrared filter is probably something like this goes up, and your camera is sensitive to infrared, so what looks like dark charcoal to us, because in fact it's warm at 1000 or 200 degrees C, the camera is already sensing it, so you have your pink charcoal in the picture. You can check if your cameras are a little bit sensitive. Or also with the remote, this the infrared remote. If you push a button in front of your camera, typically this will you will see some light from it. So that's camera. Spectral issues with camera. And I've got for reference the solar spectrum. So that's a blue curve. So solar spectrum once again in the video. And these curves are, this one is after one reflection of glass. It's about 5 or 10 millimeters of glass, I don't remember, of window glass. And this one is after two reflections. So what is the actual spectral sensitivity of the camera, and what is the source, what is the reflectivity of the target? You have to convolute all of this. And if one moves, for example, some filters, now it's much better, but 10 years, 20 years ago, the stability of the filters at the time was not good. So, once again, to take a picture with our smartphones with the camera, there is a white balance. So the white balance, between the three channels of colors, they always compensate for the lighting to adjust the gain to make a nice picture. We are doing measurements. We are not just cooking and increasing the numbers. So if we have one small drop or a big slippery or stuff like this, it's an issue. We have to calibrate for it. That's one of the last slides. So that was the sensor here. But the data is not yet out of the camera. Oh, I think this is for a monochrome camera. You have the gain, the offset, for example, for the thermal noise. Because there is noise, an increased noise inside the junction, so we have a small voltage which is due to the temperature of the sensor. So that's why, once again, for astronomy, they are cooling the sensor. So that's the analog path. Then there is the ADC, so there is the conversion from analog signal to digital signal. So there are many ways to do it. Between CCD and CMOS, it's not exactly the same way. From CCD, it's done per line, so either horizontal or vertical line. Usually it's vertical lines. There is one ADC per line. For CMOS, there is one transistor per pixel. So this is important, for example, when we have blooming. So with a sensor, if you take a picture of the sensor, there is too much light with normal camera if you don't have a very filter. And there are too many photons incoming on the pixels where there is a sun. There are so many photons coming in, so many electrons which are made, that it exceeds what is called the electrons well. For each pixel, if there are too many electrons made, they spill out of to the nearby pixels. So you have your sun, and in fact it could clear or shallow because the photons which are at one location are producing too much electrons which are filling to the others, and you have a wider with CCD sensors, that's the effect where you have the vertical stripes. If you take a picture of the sun with the green, typically it's green lines. So that's effect because of the ADC. You had so many electrons produced that the ADC doesn't have enough resistance or to get rid of this, it's a few electrons, cannot get rid of them between one pixel to the other, so one is spreading to the other for a complete line, and sometimes for several complete lines. So this is why you can get a strip, a white strip of the sun. We is CMOS sensor. When it's got too much light, it's the same. It depends how, once again, how it is done on the electronic side, the digital side. You can get black sun very neat. You have the white stuff and you see very well the black sun. So that was the ABC. We start about processing the data, so the white balance playing between the channels. It's written here, it's two but several pixels in between. This is usually to save bandwidth with many pixels. We put them together. The gamma correction, this I'll show you after. This is not linear. Sensitivity of the sensor is not linear. And this gamma correction, this is once again for the A to make nice picture. We are playing with the sensitivity curve to get enough light inside the dark stuff, and also enough light for the bright part. So instead of having something linear in our cameras, there is a gamma. So on 1.6, it's an exponential on the signal. The color interpolation, that's the Bayer stuff. So edge filters, that's in our camera. If you zoom on a smartphone, you probably got some spots, depends on the camera, but usually it's not one pixel with one color, it's a blob. And it depends, here it will look nice, but on the edge, right, it depends on the data processing how it's done. The U is different kind of color manipulation from memory, and then it's not. So this is from a scientific camera, manual vision. And I also written the dynamic of the digital signal. So this is about linearity. So this is something I did. This is from, I don't remember where. This is typically the sensitivity of a silicon-based sensor, so either CCD or CMOS, so what we are using. Basically, if you increase light, if you increase light like this, this is the attenuance, the gray levels, the signal you get on the computer. So there is an area where it looks nice, it's more or less linear, and this is already on the shelf. But if you go very high, so you are overexposing your sensor, so you don't have any more signal. But it's not very much linear expense. And on the bottom part, here it's also terrible. And if you are not careful, if we use too much too wide range, we have both the top and the bottom range, which are not usable. For example, this is for 8 bits data, so from 0 to 255, the data level. And typically, in our lab, that's PSA and DLR, we don't like to work below 30 and above 200 something, 120 units. This is cooking. See, we don't like it, we don't know very well what's going on, so we took some trial parts, we cross-fingered, is linear enough. We try to check it, but that's it. This one I got because it was a very funny issue. So a camera, you can change a lot of settings. You have seen on your own camera, you have aperture, so this is on the lens. You have exposure time. And this is what it is about. We thought it's quite common to adapt for the brightness, to change the exposure time instead of changing the filter. If we have 10 times more exposure time, we should have 10 times more photons on the sensor, so 10 times more electrons, so 10 times more signal. And for example, on this camera, once again, the scientific camera, what we did is on the black body, so something used to calibrate a parametric sensor, which is very stable. we cut the camera and we change the exposure time. So it should be linear. We should have a straight line between, if the exposure time is twice longer, we should have twice a signal. Between 300 microseconds and 600, it should be, so 300 is 30, 600 is about 70. It should be 60, not 70. And that's one first thing. You see, so this is on the three layers, blue, red, green, so we have different slopes, so different sensitivity. And the other effect, which was not nice, and I still don't have, I don't understand why, you see steps here. So this is not issue with the acquisition system. It means that if you ask for the camera for 300 microseconds of exposure time, or 290, or 310, it's in fact doing exactly the same exposure time. We have four steps. And this kind of effect, so this is on one camera. I have several models, several examples of this model of camera. Each looks similar, but it's not the same issues. So with this kind of stuff, and so this is with IVT, with the Sony sensor and so on. Colleagues from DLR also saw stuff like this. Now we don't change the exposure time, because unless we check what is the signal between exposure time A and exposure time B, we have this kind of issue coming very quickly, and we cannot just calculate and normalize this exposure time. So I told you how to get data, brightness. This is just to get gray levels, And to compensate gray levels to kilowatt per square meter, we have to calibrate the whole system on the radiometric system. How much this gray, this nice gray with all those curves, how much kilowatt per square meter it is. And the very common way is to use one of the direct sensors I showed you earlier. So here it's a calorimeter or a Gardon gauge. So you take on the towers, you have the big target, and at one place there is, so on the tower it's usually a Gardon gauge. So we take this white target, we try to make it a nice picture. And at this location we know the kilowatt per square meter, we know the gray levels around, so we divide in between and we have the calibration sensor, the calibration factor for the whole setup. That's the common way to get kilowatt per square meter once we have a nice picture. This is what I just said. So for example, this is this was comparison between several sensors, so Gardon gauge. Sencatch is two calorimeters at different positions and to check with the lambda sensor target what is going on. So this so-called white target. After this, we got a nice picture, we got a calibration system. So this is normal numerical calculation. And one point is to be careful during the cooking, because typical pictures, they are from 0 to 208 bits. With scientific camera, we quickly have 12 or 14 bits, sometimes 16. This is still not very wide range of data, so do not forget to convert to a wider system. Do not use Photoshop to process this. Photoshop is not meant for this. To remove the dust, okay, it's, or the flies coming on the targets, so Photoshop, okay. To make calculation, no. It's so MATLAB, of course, MATLAB, Scilab, Python. Python is a bit tricky. Or ImageG. ImageG is a software, free software, which was written for the, at first for biology, so to count cells and stuff like this. And the guy from biology, as it was open source, the guy from astronomy used it, and they released a lot of radiometric features which are interesting for us. So when I process data by hand, for example, I, my lab, we are using an image. it's, when it is not by hand, it's C++ with OpenCV, for example, or in Python, either with OpenCV or other libraries. So how to store data, this is an advertising for this format. So it's, once again, BMP, do not use a JPEG. A JPEG is compression, it's a destructive compression, it's a feature, it's meant for the A. So human A, once again, when there is what looks like for a human being a flat color, here, instead of storing a lot of pixels, they're storing one big, which is the average color here. And for us, it's not good because in fact there are small differences here and we are losing this data. So JPEG is useless. Using PNG or TIFF format which have non-destructive compression. A FIX is image format which has been developed for astronomy. Theoretically, because you can store in it metadata. So what is your camera, the settings, the DNI, and stuff like this. And the wireless newcomer is an ECF5, which allows to store anything, so from 1D to whatever, any dimensional data, and to go very fast inside this data. So, for example, the 3D plotting I showed you, so to have slices and to make tomographic plans. So for example, in the receiver, we are doing, if we take picture in parallel plans, if we want to see what is on the walls, to assemble this kind of data, it's very convenient. So this is summary for the camera. We need a calorimeter or galvan gauge to calibrate. We need DNI. First, when there was the direct sensor installed, so the galvan gauge or the calorimeter or whatever, and also when you are doing your picture, so the DNI, the DHI, the GHI, the spectrum, the aerial source, as many data. You need a picture like this for x-ray parameters to calibrate what is 1 centimeter, whatever is north, where is west, and like this. The actual image. So this is from the picture at the beginning from the one of the sort of places. And after post-processing, we can produce this kind of map. That was for camera. And should be in one of my last slides. Ray tracing has been covered yesterday, so I won't go very much in detail on it. We can calculate the flux map. The issue is we need to know very well what we are putting inside the computer. A model is only as good as the input data is. So the sun, Manuel showed it yesterday, so it's very nice. The CSR, what is the sun, what is the brightness, what is the DNI. The atmosphere, what is inside the atmosphere, if you are very far, it starts to see the rays. What is, so the optics, he said it about, okay, you have an ideal heliostat, but this doesn't exist. This is only on CNC software. In reality, each heliostat is different. It's a bit like this, a bit like that. So you want it to track here, it's in fact tracking here. There is winds, there is thermal dilatation, there is aging, backlash. So you need to calibrate this to have this data. That's for the position. The optical properties, so is it clean? Is it old mirror, new mirror? The dust? What thickness of the glass, the waviness of the glass? You need information about it. They showed yesterday, even if you have a really good, impossible knowledge of your system, the way you calculate it, so Cyril showed yesterday with the convolution, which is very old, so 40, 60 years old techniques, because you can do it analytical. It's very convenient, it's fast, but it's not as precise because you make assumption in your system. You simplify your geometry. The analytical model, so more or less everything about ray tracing, so Monte Carlo based, Russian roulette, and so on, all these systems. It's a mathematics, you put over the physics, and which one you choose, make a difference. And at the end, the software, is certainly presented software which actually does it, even if it is same math. How is it done? How is it implemented? It depends, your result will depend on that. That's probably my last, my before last slide. This is an overview. You can go check those two reports. So the most important is that one. We did it in a European project, so me or the colleague Sparko was for other topics then. So they are available on this website, so the Sphera website. There is a new project, a current ongoing project within Sphera 2, but this we cover other work in Sphera 2. This was done in the Sphera project, so it's, this report is very interesting. It's maybe 100 pages, 120, something like this. The objective, so it's 3 years old. The objective was to cover the qualification of everything in CSP. So it started to define the stuff. This slide, for example, at the beginning I show kilowatt, kilowatt per square meter, the words. The words, definition, and then to cover quickly for each component how to measure it. So for murals, for mechanical, the tracking error something, and there is a chapter on flux measurement. And one for better measurement. This one is dedicated for flux measurement, so most of the guidelines are the same parts, and here's also practical procedures, a few practical procedures how to do it, not just theory like I presented. That's it. So, thank you for your
attention. So, thank you. I'm interested in the guarding gauge and the moving bar application. And as far as I know, the guarding gauge has a response time in the order of a few seconds. So, I mean, it depends on the thickness of the foil. But it, will it be below a second?
Yeah. So I don't remember exactly the response time from the one we use, but it's 10, maybe 100 hertz. It's we're speaking in hertz quite quickly. And then, for example, in Temis, in our power plant tower, we bought not a garden gauge, but a Spitbutter. It's like this from Vattel, and this one is a few kilohertz. In speed, so because we have a moving bar which is much faster.
Do you remember the foil thickness of these?
Nope. It's a bit like one finger, but
not the gauge thickness, the foil. I mean, it's a tenth of a millimeter.
Should be something like this, but I don't know the effect. I had reviewed a paper they were building, it was a Schmidt-Butter once again. Because to have signal, more signal.
Yeah.
And it was, they claim to go to 30 or 50 kilohertz. So it was for combustion applications. The CapTech is also very fast, it's 10, 100 hertz.